Hello everyone and welcome to Kaizen Learning. In today's video, we are going to do a poem analysis on The Walrus and the Carpenter, written by Lewis Carroll. Born on 27th Jan 1832, Lewis Carroll was the pen name of Charles Lutwidge Dodgson. He was born in a small village, Dasbury, England. He was an English writer, mathematician, logician and photographer. He used to spend all his time writing for children or telling stories to them. Alice's Adventures in Wonderland and its sequel, Through the Looking Glass, are some of his best and widely read works. He loved to create nonsense poems with unusual words such as the Jabberwocky and the Hunting of the Snark. The Walrus and the Carpenter is a narrative poem that first appeared in Through the Looking Glass, published in 1871. The poem is recited by the twins, Tweedledum and Tweedledee, to Alice. It is a nonsense poem depicting Carroll's usage of humorous fantasies and childlike verses. The poem shows two characters, the walrus and the carpenter, walking along a beach where they find a bed of oysters. Seeing them, they decide to eat them all. So, before we begin with the poem, let me give you a gist of what this poem is about. So, this poem is about a walrus and a carpenter who trick innocent and young oysters and eat them after a walk on the seashore. It also deals with the idea of cunningness in human nature. So, the theme of the poem is wisdom, betrayal and death. This is an 18 stanza poem with 6 lines each and the rhyme scheme is A, B, C, B, D, B. So, the rhyme scheme is A, B, C, B, D, B and it has end rhymes like fat chat, low row, quick, thick. So, now let us begin with understanding each stanza in detail. First stanza. The sun was shining on the sea, shining with all his might. He did his very best to make the billows smooth and bright. And this was odd because it was the middle of the night. So, here in the first stanza, the speaker says that even though it was middle of the night, the sun was still shining bright with all his power and the best of what he could. Now here the sun trying to shine at night was a little odd thing. Now the second stanza. The moon was shining sulkily because she thought the sun had got no business to be there after the day was done. It's very rude of him, she said, to come and spoil the fun. In the second stanza, the poet is talking about the moon. So he says that the moon was sad because the sun was present. Now the moon thought that it is night time, so the sun shouldn't be there. She feels that the sun should appear in the morning time only. They both have their own specific time to appear. So the moon thought that it was rude that sun appeared and it was spoiling the fun. Third stanza. The sea was wet could be. The sands were dry as dry. You could not see a cloud because no cloud was in the sky. No birds were flying overhead. There were no birds to fly. In the third stanza, the speaker describes the sea, sand and sky. So he says that the sea was wet and the sand was dry, which means that according to him, that the sea had taken up a huge space and the remaining part of the land was taken away by the sand. He also says that the sky was clear because there were no clouds and no birds. Fourth stanza. The walrus and the carpenter were walking close at hand. They wept like anything to see such quantities of sand. If this were only cleared away, they said, it would be grand. So, in the fourth stanza, the speaker talks about the characters of the poem. So, in the previous three stanzas, he was talking about the background or the setting of the poem. He says that the two friends, Walrus and the Carpenter, were walking together. Close at hands means they were walking side by side. Now, as they were walking on the shore, they cried for the quantity of sand that was spread on the land and wished for it to be cleared away. So then the entire land would be covered with sea, and the walrus didn't have to walk so much and he could easily swim. So here he's saying that the land represents or is for the carpenter to walk, and the water is for the walrus to swim. Fifth stanza. If seven maids with seven mops swept it for half a year, do you suppose, the walrus said, that they could get it clear? I doubt it, said the carpenter, and shed a bitter tear. So, in the fifth stanza, the walrus is wondering, what would it take to move the sand? So, the walrus asks to the carpenter, if seven maids use seven mops, then maybe the sand on this land can be cleared away in just half a year, which is in just 6 months. Now the carpenter doubts to this while he sheds a tear. Sixth stanza. O oysters, come and walk with us, the walrus did beseech. A pleasant walk, a pleasant talk along the briny beach. We cannot do with more than four to give a hand to each. So, in the sixth stanza, the speaker now introduces another characters, which is the oysters. So, he says that as the walrus and carpenter were walking along the beach, they met the oysters and begged them to join them for a walk on this salty beach. So the walrus tries to convince the oysters by telling them that they would have a pleasant walk and talk and they would enjoy. So he says that one per head, okay, which means that two oysters will hold the walrus's hand and the rest and the other two oysters can hold the carpenter's hand. Seventh stanza. The eldest oyster looked at him, but never a word he said. The eldest oyster winked his eye and shook his heavy head, meaning to say he did not choose to leave the oyster bed. So, in the seventh stanza, the speaker now introduces the eldest oyster. Okay, so the eldest oyster was too wise to leave the oyster bed. So, he simply didn't say no to the walrus, but he winked his eye and shook his head, indicating that he is not interested for the walk. He didn't want it to be carried away with the sweet talk of the walrus. Maybe he knew what was going to happen, or maybe he knew how the walrus was. Eighth stanza. But four young oysters hurried up, all eager for the treat. Their coats were brushed, their faces washed, their shoes were clean and neat. And this was odd because, you know, they hadn't any feet. So, in the eighth stanza, the speaker says that four oysters hurried to go for the walk. They dressed themselves by brushing the coat, washing their faces, cleaning their shoes, keeping them clean and neat, shining. Even though they did not have any feet, they did all these activities because they were so excited. They were very happy and they were very excited again because someone had invited them for a walk. Ninth stanza. Four other oysters followed them, and yet another four. And thick and fast they came at last, and more and more and more, all hopping through the frothy waves and scrambling to the shore. So, in the ninth stanza, the speaker says that at first only four oysters got ready, but then more came in, then again more came in, and then again more. So this way the count or the number of the oysters kept on increasing. Now so many oysters had joined for the walk on the shore with the walrus and the carpenter, and all of them were equally excited. 10th stanza. The walrus and the carpenter walked a mile or so, and then they rested on a rock, conveniently low, and all the little oysters stood and waited in a... So, in the 10th stanza, the walrus and the carpenter started walking with all the other oysters, and they walked and walked for a mile, and then they all got tired, so they rested on the small rock. And along with the walrus and the carpenter, the other oysters also waited in a row. 11th stanza. The time has come, the walrus said, to talk of many things, of shoes and ships and sealing wax, of cabbages and kings, and why the sea is boiling hot, and whether the pigs have wings. So, in the 11th stanza, the walrus told the oysters that now they all can rest and talk for a while. So, it was the right time to talk about something really important, like shoes, ships, sealing wax, cabbages, kings, why the sea water has become warm, and whether the pigs have wings. So, these were all the topics that the walrus wanted to discuss with the oyster. So, he tried to indulge all of them for a talk. 12th stanza. But wait a bit, the oysters cried. Before we have our chat, for some of us are out of breath and all of us are fat. No hurry, said the carpenter. They thanked him much for that. So, in the 12th stanza, the oysters say that before they chat, okay, they would like to rest since all of them were fat and out of breath. Now, out of breath means they were facing difficulty in breathing because of the long walk that they had, and they thanked the walrus for allowing them to take rest. So, the oysters thought that the walrus and carpenter took rest because of them. So this made them feel very kind-hearted of the walrus and the carpenter. 13th stanza. A loaf of bread, the walrus said, is what we chiefly need. Pepper and vinegar, besides, are very good indeed. Now, if you're ready, oysters dear, we can begin to feed. So, in the 13th stanza, the walrus says that for the party, we mainly need a loaf of bread, okay, for the treat that they are going to have. All of them just needs a loaf of bread. And if we get pepper and vinegar, then it would really be great. So, he asks the oyster that if they are ready, then they can start eating all of them one by one. 14th stanza. But not on us, the oysters cried, turning a little blue. After such kindness, that would be a dismal thing to do. The night is fine, the walrus said. Do you admire the view? So, in the 14th stanza, the oysters could not believe what the walrus said. After such kindness of inviting them for a walk, then having fun, having talks and chat, the walrus got all the way here just to eat them. They all got scared and their faces turned blue in shock. It was a sad and a horrible thing that was done to them by the walrus. But the walrus was heartless. He was cruel and he said that the night was fine and he didn't mind eating them. He even asks the oysters if they liked the view and the place of their death. 15th stanza. It was so kind of you to come, and you're very nice. The carpenter said nothing but cut us another slice. I wish you were not quite so deaf. I've had to ask you twice. So, in the 15th stanza, the walrus thanked the oysters for coming in and said that they were really very nice. So, the walrus said, thank you for falling into the trap. And the carpenter asked the walrus to cut some more bread so that they could eat the oysters. So, he scolded the walrus for having to be told twice to do it. The carpenter here is busy scolding the walrus. 16th stanza. It seems a shame, the walrus said, to play them such a trick after we've brought them out so far and made them trot so quick. The carpenter said nothing, but the butters spread too thick. In the 16th stanza, the walrus feels sorry that they both had to trick the oysters for a walk so that they could eat them. While he was expressing his apology and grief, the carpenter was busy complaining that there was too much of butter applied on the bread. So, he was not sorry to the oysters, nor he was bothered for the oysters. He was just waiting for the oysters to be killed so that he can put inside those slices of bread and eat them. 17th stanza. I weep for you, the walrus said. I deeply sympathize. With sobs and tears, he sorted out those of the largest size, holding his pocket handkerchief before his streaming eyes. So, in the 17th stanza, the walrus cried for the oysters and his eyes were full of tears. While he was about to wipe his tears with his pocket-sized handkerchief, he was busy sorting the largest oyster to eat. He even said that he deeply sympathized with them. 18th stanza. O oysters, said the carpenter, you've had a pleasant run. Shall we be trotting home again? But answer came there none. And this was scarcely odd, because they'd eaten everyone. So, in the 18th stanza, the carpenter ends the poem by asking the oysters, how was the walk and how was the run on the beach? You must be tired now. Shall we run home again? But no oysters replied to this, because there were no more oysters left, since all of them had been eaten away by the carpenter and the walrus. So, what do we learn from this poem? We learn that we should not follow anyone blindly. We should first think and then take action. Now here the walrus and the carpenter, both of them were strangers. So we should never trust the strangers easily. Remember the oldest oyster at the beginning when he very clearly refused? Yes. So that decision made by the oldest oyster refused to talk to the strangers. So, he saved his life. So, what do we learn from this poem? We learn that we should never follow anyone blindly. Now, remember how those four oysters joined in with the walrus and the carpenter, and then looking at them, more and more oysters started joining in without even knowing anything where they are going or what they are going to do. So we should first think and then take action. Now the carpenter and the walrus, both of them were strangers to the oysters. Okay, so we should never trust strangers so easily. And the eldest oyster at the beginning, we should learn from him how his wise decision saved his life. So, this brings us to the end of today's poem. I hoped you all had a wonderful time learning and understanding the poem better. I will see you in the next video. Till then, stay safe and stay curious.